Thank you for the kind invitation. The American College of Thessaloniki, the Dukakis Center, Professor Kyriakidou, Dr. Bozoudi, Professor Wisner, and all the other good friends and former colleagues. You know, Haris is a great speaker. So since I'm, let's say, the academic of the group, I might sound a little bit boring in the beginning. The idea is also, let's say, to provide a methodological framework regarding political participation in general and youth political participation in particular as food for thought for your upcoming debate. So this will be the first part of my talk, and the second part will be more focus on EU affairs and the challenges that we're facing today. Of course, in principle, you know that political participation plays a very crucial role for the development of democracy, shaping its institutions, embedding and legitimizing them socially. I'm saying that because one of our inconvenient truths today is that democratic legitimacy is being challenged. Although we have differences among European countries, there is a considerable lack of connection between political institutions and their social environment, with both being affected. Not only does insufficient legitimacy diminish the capacity of democratic institutions to shape widely acceptable policies and to implement them effectively, but also it weakens the integrity and the functioning of our society. So therefore, because you know, in our analysis, a lot of times we talk about the European level, but we need to start from the national one, what is happening. It should be beyond doubt that democracies in Europe have one clear imperative at present: how to strengthen their anchoring and legitimacy in society, and the EU will come as well. Only if we embrace society more broadly will society be able to exert control over its elites, political and otherwise, and more than ever before, to withstand the real danger of democratic temptations invoked by the rising populists, nationalists, and demagogues. We know from all our surveys that young people seem to show considerable reluctance to engage in conventional democratic politics. We know that young people's interest in traditional form of politics and political parties is said to be declining, which can be seen, among others, from the declining levels of voting and membership in youth sections, not only in Europe, but also in political parties and youth organizations as a whole. The pessimistic conclusion is that in turning their backs on democratic institutions, the young of today are jeopardizing the democracy of tomorrow. Is this actually the way? However, the massive decline in young people's traditional political participation does not necessarily indicate a rejection of politics per se. It can also illustrate a transformation of forms of participation, which become less institutionalized and more flexible. Take for example, internet, social media, and new forms of political participation. So in this respect, all these new forms of social and political involvement appear to emerge among young people. So all these indicate a more fundamental transformation of contemporary democracy over the years to come. So youth political participation is also a discussion about shaping democracy today and tomorrow. So as a result, future democratic legitimacy is to some extent determined by the political socialization young people undergo today. And the next couple of hours and days, you're going to have a very good example of political socialization between young people facilitated by colleagues and practitioners. So, and while this may sound like a truism, one wonders whether the existing means of helping young people to become citizens are sufficient to secure their understanding and support of, as well as active engagement in democratic institutions. You know, sometimes we understand that maybe we do not speak the same language, although we know that we want the same things. The narrative has to be different. For example, let's take the issue of political participation and the discussion on a European citizenship and on a European identity. The secret of Europe has been its ability to transcend its differences via historic breakthroughs that have led into bold pan-European solution. So the idea was that my European choice had to transcend the national one. As such, to be a European citizen means to be European plus Greek, means to be European plus Irish, meaning that you cannot think as a French without also thinking as a European. I know it's a little bit vague. That's why we need to work on that and have better results. The same debates about the future of Europe suggest that the people most likely to develop commitment to a European citizenship as participants in an open democratic project are those who are active citizens, engaging with civic society in their own nation state. The extent to which young people might describe as active citizens when we explore it, for example, through their willingness to vote in local elections, in national elections, as well as, of course, European elections, where, unfortunately, the turnout is even lower, but also by taking interest in a range of political and social issues. It's not only a question about voting and Finns. No, this is only the beginning. So those who were active citizens in this sense were also more likely to identify themselves as European. While there is, of course, cross-country variation, it is clear that active citizenship at local or national level and identification with Europe go hand in hand and can be mutually supporting. So I'm sure, and this is one of your tasks, that young people have a fervent desire to do politics differently, using creative forms. And this is what we would like to come from you. Not actually to imitate, to copy-paste what the politicians, what the elites, even people from my generation say or repeat. This can actually represent a brand new resource of pan-European energy and creativity in the political arena that the EU desperately needs, that we all need. This can reinforce traditional democracy and politics, focusing politics, for example, on the issues that interest young people most, such as the effects of globalization, environment, human rights, equality, migration. All these can be quite productive. But at least from my point of view, the political rationale should be that young people must participate in all forms of decision making, in policies that affect their lives and, of course, interest them. And now I'm coming to today's event. We need more support for various forms of learning to participate. So activities like this one emphasize the development of experiences of participation in all forms of life. Some of us have started in family, then in school, then in youth organizations, universities, and other places of education and work, in sporting, leisure context, and all that. So formal education across Europe on participation and citizenship has been limited in its success. Young people want lessons in which they could discuss the politics of the day using active methods and have a greater say in how, for example, their school is run. Schools that implement democratic and participation methods, such as having successful school councils that included young people in decision-making processes, were shown to teach young people active citizenship and give them a greater interest in politics as a whole. And you know, Anatolia College and the American College of Thessaloniki, you know, are prime examples of this pattern. So young people generally lack the ability to implement their knowledge of their rights and responsibilities as citizens of their nation or Europe. So, and I'm closing with the issue of political participation and then focusing to Europe for the next few minutes. So those with an interest in young people's political participation need both a critical perspective on the changing forms of political participation amongst different groups of young people, but also an appreciation of the wider social, cultural, political, and economic context in which young people are living. For example, everybody in politics, including me, desires the participation of the young. But in what exactly? In what they think young people should participate in? It is true that youth participation is crucial to overcome apathy in the political process. But honest policy at grassroots level can do this job even better. If such participation is lacking, there is no need to spread a kind of moral panic about the young and their distance from the public policies. Youth participation does not come cheap anymore, okay? And it's your fight that it has to be won in the context of a real offer to share power. It is time this happened. We have seen, and I'm closing with the European context, during the last couple of weeks, the last 2 weeks, I think, you know, the French president, Emmanuel Macron, and from Germany, Ms. Kramp-Karrenbauer, she's, let's say, Chancellor Merkel's successor as leader of the Christian Democrats in Germany. They have published op-eds about their views, you know, the views from Germany and France about the future of Europe. They have laid out what might be a fourth narrative about the future of a united Europe. The first was about peace, the second was about prosperity, the third was about democratic transformation and the big back Eastern enlargement. The fourth story is about the protection of what the French president describes using the term civilization, and what does actually this mean for all of us. And Ms. Kramp-Karrenbauer calls the European way of life. So basically, both of them are almost talking about the same things. So it's about representative democracy, the rule of law, individual freedom, even a social market economy. No, a third way compared to the model in the United States. They are talking, in other words, about preserving really the extraordinary achievements of three quarters of a century on a continent previously torn apart and destroyed by two world wars. Of course, the warring rise of EU intergovernmentalism explains to a great extent the bypassing of European institutions. And that is why it's also important to have a very strong European Parliament the next day. The powers will be the same, but the turnout is also important. If you have, for example, very low turnouts, imagine it's easier for the member states, for the intergovernmental institutions, to set aside the European Parliament. This is our voice. This is where the peoples of Europe are represented. We're also very concerned about the dangerous gap between Europe's institutions, the politics of renationalization, okay, my country first, for example, alongside the schism that we had between the national elites following the debt crisis in Europe. This underscores the seriousness of the present crisis and how it is different from those of the past, having established a persisting leadership crisis and a continuous EU leadership one. So to cut a long story short, democracy without politics is not democracy. So today we are facing a rising political and not merely democratic deficit. The European Union has become almost a victim of its success. Our philosophy was that we will be judged by results and sacrifice the process, highlighting the idea of a results-oriented legitimacy. Therefore, establishing a political process which relied primarily on the results. And actually, the results were not only good, they were also impressive. But unfortunately, during the last decade, the results have not satisfied the European public. And then what? Now you have a part of the peoples of Europe questioning, even challenging the whole enterprise of the European project, which is facing an almost existential threat. Now we are collectively paying the price for not paying enough attention to the processes that have been followed. So in this respect, institutional reforms at the EU level, with the Parliament a front runner in this endeavor, can be a response to the criticism coming about the Brussels bureaucracy. And this would be also an effort in order to address Europe's democratic deficit and elite-driven aspects. It goes without saying that the initial collective failure of the European Union during the economic crisis, the likely persistence, you know, of fragmentation for years to come, and the rise of popular anti-establishment reaction against national elites and Brussels, as well, of course, you know, the broader globalization process, you know, all these battles between the winners and losers of globalization, all these reveal the serious challenges entailed in future and further integration. Those are the challenges to be met if Europe, as one of my colleagues from Germany recently wrote in the Financial Times, that these are the challenges to be met if Europe is to be a diner rather than dinner in the emerging of a new and possibly, you know, less coordinated but still liberal world order. Drawing a conclusion, evidence suggests much higher levels of engagement when young people are asked to discuss the topic of political participation in their own words. So, in your own words, taking into consideration your distinct perspectives, your own insights, seize the essence of the European project on an ever closer union of the peoples of Europe. To think, question, and above all, to act on who will govern us and on how we will be governed. 2 weeks ago, Yanis Bechrakis, the award-winning Reuters photojournalist, passed away. In one of his interviews, Yanis mentioned, I'm interested in poking people and say to them, hey, look what is happening. You need to do something. I'm interested to be one of the people that have been writing the history of my generation. And Yanis said, and I wanted to write it down correctly and with ethos. Bechrakis' views highlight our obligation for proactive responsibility. The unfinished business should not be put on hold. That is the least we owe to the founding fathers of the European idea for Europe to remain free, whole, and at peace. And please, please, don't take all of them for granted. This was not the historic example of history, of Europe, I'm sorry. So, in principle, the Europeans, all of us, the Europeans, have been distinguished partners in making diversity the servant and not the master of our destiny. The risk at this moment is that the Union might be taking too long and doing too little, thus wasting ammunition in light of the fact that policy options and relevant tools might not be available forever. Last but not least, as Harris stressed, in the end of May, do not forget to exercise your fundamental democratic right. As time matters more than ever before, do not forget to vote. It might sound like another cliché, but again, this time, united we stand, divided we fall. So please do not forget our joint European venture. Please do not forget our common European future. Thank you.